Kamran Wafa, only the ones who are attending online need to register. Those who are present do not need to register for it. Registration is only because those who are connecting via Zoom, they needed to be able to connect to the Zoom room. Okay, so now I guess we can start. Please, Mark.
Okay, good morning. So let me continue from where I stopped yesterday. One small thing I left to say was about the statistics of perturbations. And we know they are very close to Gaussian. It is also a prediction of slow roll inflation in the sense that imagine you have a free field, and which means, right, doesn't interact at all. And then, imagine you want to compute the three-point function, which...
Wait. It's not being recorded.
It was all false, what I said. So, no. Giving lectures used to be much easier. Now, even when I teach at my university, I'm always afraid that I forget to click to register. Shall we start again? Thank you. So we were saying that imagine you want to compute the three-point function. And you know that if you have free fields, this will vanish. Just imagine making quantum operator, right, annihilation creation operators, and this clearly gives zero. So if these are free fields, and then you can imagine, okay, let me assume that the inflaton is not free because it's interacting with itself. And so you would, how do you encode the interaction of the inflaton? Well, simply you put them in the potential, right? So you can tailor expand the potential. So this would be something like this. Let me tailor expand it around the origin, assuming that I have a minimum in the origin where it vanishes. And then, however, you see that the interactions are proportional to derivative of the potentials. And the slow roll parameters being small, remember, constrain the derivative of the potential to be small. And so essentially also non-Gaussianity is going to be small, just because these are small self-interactions. Of course, we could consider interactions with other fields. This could enhance the non-Gaussianity, and that's something that we will discuss on last lecture. Okay, so yesterday I made some claim about perturbations. I wanted to make a quick calculation to support or to justify some of these claims. But what I'm going to do is really a toy model, and it is a test massless field in the sitter. So this is really a toy model for the perturbations. So I'm not going to perturb the metric. And by mean test, I mean that I neglect the energy of this field from the point of view of the expansion of the universe. So you know that when you give the line element for the sitter, we can use the physical time. And in this case, A is equal e to the ht, essentially. So this is how you do it. But you can also use conformal time. Well, you can do many things, but this will be two coordinates that we will discuss. In this case, the scale factor, we write it minus 1 over h tau. And then inflation, the sitter, is done in this portion here. So tau goes to zero minus during inflation, and the scale factor grows like this. So why we are using conformal time? Because it's easier to do calculations for fields. So because we will write S the action of the field, d for x minus g, g mu nu, d mu phi, d nu phi. Massless field, so I didn't add any potential. And you see that's what I'm writing, right, for the action of the field. And now you see that from the square root of the determinant, you get a scale factor to the fourth power. And then from here, you get scale factor to the minus 2. So this would give a half d for x a squared eta mu nu d mu phi d nu phi. If I go to momentum space, this will be a half dt d3k, and then I have a square phi dot square plus k square phi square. Then what I can do, this will be the Fourier modes of the field. Sorry, and there is an a square also here, of course. Now, we like to have canonically normalized field, because you see this is not the canonical normalization. So we are going to define chi a phi. This is canonically normalized. And the equation that we get for chi, that's essentially what I want to discuss, is this equation here. Chi, and here, sorry, let me use consistent notation. Derivative with respect to conformal time, people usually call it prime. So let me just put a prime. So the equation of motion for the field chi is going to be the following one. And you can see, right, that this term, in reality, is 2a squared h squared. And now we can see that there are two regimes. You see from the equation. Remember, yesterday I was telling you that the field is initially inside the horizon, then it goes outside the horizon. And you can see from the equation, because inside the horizon means that the scale factor initially is very small. So this term initially is subdominant. And what we get the same equation as a simple harmonic oscillator in Minkowski. This justifies what I was telling you yesterday, right? And we know what it is the solution here. We take the solution, which is the normalized one in Minkowski, e to the minus ikt divided by square root of 2k. And then when you go out of the horizon, you get this different term. So you see that there is really a different behavior. And you see that this has a minus sign, which means that you're going to amplify the mode. That's the amplification due to the expansion of the universe. And the solution, which is the one that gets the right initial condition, is chi is equal 1 minus I k tau divided by square root of 2k e to the minus I k tau. Remember that remember the time as I was doing before? So this is tau, this is a, this is the scale factor. So early times means tau goes to minus infinite. So if tau goes to minus infinite, the numerator here becomes 1, and you see the usual Minkowski-like normalization. Instead, late time, so if I now do look at this at late time, it means that I take tau goes to 0. And so you see now that it's different. You'll get minus I square root of 2k to the 3 half times tau. So that's what the mode does when tau goes to 0, right? The phase vanishes, and this term becomes the dominant one. Now, remember that the original field was phi. So phi is chi over a, which is minus h tau chi, because that's what the scale factor is. And now if I put everything together, I'll get I square root of 2 k to the 3/2 h. And particularly what is we see that indeed the field becomes constant. This is the frozen field that I was telling you yesterday. You see, there's no more dependence on time. So there is the oscillation during inside the horizon, and then the field freezes to a constant value. Now we can ask what is the power of this field. And to get the power, I'm going to do it short, but essentially we can just take the average of the square of the field, because this is a perturbation, right? So the average of the field itself will be zero. But here, if you go to Fourier space, you do some algebra, you're going to find what I also wrote yesterday. This is k cube divided by 2 pi squared phi squared. And this is what we call the power spectrum of phi as a function of k. So now let's put this together. So you see that when you take phi squared, you get 1 over k cube. That exactly cancels with this k cube. And what we end up with is h over 2 pi squared. So you see that this is a scale invariant and constant. So these are the properties that I was telling you yesterday. Yesterday we were arguing, right? But now we see it from the calculation. So now in reality, right, we know that inflation is not the sitter. So for example, h decreases during inflation. So this will tell me that the power decreases. So when I do evaluate this quantity, if h decreases, I should evaluate it at horizon crossing. So modes that cross the horizon at different time, they will have different power. But in reality, as I told you, this is not the full calculation. Like when you do the full calculation, you need to add also the metric perturbation. And these you can find very nice reviews, which I will not have time here to cover. But when you add also the metric perturbation, the calculation that I did becomes a bit more complicated. And what one ends up with the things that I was telling you yesterday. So now we would add delta phi, delta g mu nu. We would include the delta phi in the Einstein equation, so this will not be anymore a test field. And at the end of the day, you find what I was telling you yesterday. The spectral tilt is ns, 1 minus 6 epsilon plus 2 eta. Remember, epsilon is m Planck square half v prime over v square. Eta is m Planck square v prime prime over v. And remember that this quantity are much smaller than 1. And R, so the tensor to scalar ratio, R 16 epsilon. Remember, we defined essentially P zeta goes as lambda 1 minus ns and R P gravitational wave divided by P zeta. So just to summarize, this calculation was done for a test field in the sitter, and the purpose was to show you the transition between the sub-horizon regime to the super-horizon regime, and also to show you concretely that indeed the field freezes, and the power, you see, becomes scale invariant. Now, this is the calculation that we did, and now I'm making some statements without fully proving them, that when you add also the metric perturbation, and when you also include the relation between them in the Einstein equations, then you'll find some more general properties. You will find that the spectral tilt, the scale dependence of the power, is given by the Slow-Rolle parameters, and also the tensor to scalar ratio is given by the Slow-Rolle parameters. Now, during inflation, we use the number of e-folds. As a measure of time as well. And we define them, n, to be the logarithm of the scale factor at the end of inflation about divided by the scale factor with some function of time. So during inflation, A is of course smaller than the final result, right? And so N is greater than zero, because you do the logarithm of something greater than one. At the end of inflation, A is equal A and, therefore N is equal zero. So N decreases during inflation. Okay, so n is a parameter that is decreasing, and when n is equal to zero means the end of inflation. So now imagine that I give you all these, and I ask you, okay, now tell me the phenomenology for a given potential of inflation. For example, I'm asking you, okay, let's take this model here. Let me copy the relations upstairs. So ns 1 minus 6 epsilon plus 2 eta, r 16 epsilon. And then I tell you, okay, here is the model of inflation. Let me take the simplest. This model is now ruled out, but let me just discuss this because it's the simpler one to do calculations. I just tell you I have a massive inflaton field with quadratic potential. Tell me what is the value of ns for this model and what is the value of r for this model. So what you do, right, first of all, you draw it so that you get a feeling what's going on. And now you see, naively, right, it seems that you say, oh, but the potential becomes steeper when I go far higher up. It doesn't look flat. But remember that these are the flatness parameters that you need to evaluate. So for example, if you compute epsilon, this is equal m Planck squared divided by 2. Then here you have the derivative of the potential, so m squared phi divided by the potential itself. So you see this gets 2 m Planck squared divided by phi squared. So you see that for this potential, the greater phi is, the more flat indeed the potential is. It does, because flatness, remember, you need also to take this into account. If you take eta, now you do the second derivative. This is m squared phi squared. No, m squared, that's it. A half m squared phi squared. You get the same result. So you see here that inflation ends, if here is phi, here is v. Inflation essentially ends when phi is a square root of 2m Planck. So phi comes from here, goes down. And when phi reaches square root of 2m Planck, that's the moment that inflation ends, because the Slorolle parameters are no longer smaller than 1. Now, but what you need to do, essentially, you need to evaluate these relations at some given moment during inflation. Because this is the end of inflation, so this is the value of phi at the end of inflation. But the value of phi when the CMB mods were produced was higher. So this is the value phi CMB. And the question is, what should we put here for this value phi CMB? The first thing that we can do, we can solve the equations of motion, and this will be left to you as homework. So the first thing that you do, you need to find phi as a function of n. And this will be a homework that I will post later. I will guide you. You just look at the equation of motion for the scalar field, and you will be able to find phi as a function of n. For this potential, what you find phi nearly equal 4n plus 2 m Planck. And in the homework, I will guide you to solve this. It's not very hard. When you see n is equal to 0, indeed, you find that phi is square root of 2m Planck. But when n is greater than 0, phi is bigger. So right, this tells me, right, the farther away phi is, the bigger is the number of e-foli, means the earlier I am during inflation. And now, if you just now take this number and you put it here, right, in the formula for epsilon and for eta, and then you put this formula here, you will get the phenomenological prediction for this model. Right? You have phi as a function of n, so you can compute the slow roll parameters as a function of number of e-folds, and so you can compute these two quantities as a function of e-folds. Okay? And what we get the prediction ns is 1 minus 2 over n, and r is 8 over n. So now, right, you see that essentially the question still remains, in a sense, which value of n should I use? So these are the predictions, but the question is what? So is it clear? We use n as a function of time, as a measure of time. So we give the value of the inflaton as a function of number of e-folds. And so we can do the phenomenological prediction as a number, as a function of the number of e-folds. If you change the potential, you can just use the same machinery. You will just get some different functions here. But once you solve the homework, you will see that you have a tool to do it for any potential that you want. But now the question remains, and maybe you have heard that n is equal to 60, but why, right? So that's what we have to discuss now. Do you have any questions so far? Very good. Yes, please.
Since the field is has the same scale as Planck scale, should we be concerned about corrections to the theory?
Yeah, very much so. And in fact, there's a lot of problems in these models because, for example, if you try to embed them in string theory, it is really not simple. And even if you just try to have a consistent theory of quantum gravity, you don't know whether you can trust your potential for these field values. There's a huge literature about it. So indeed, it's a concern that people address.
Okay, but is this model still acceptable or not?
What do you mean by acceptable?
I mean, it explains data, right?
No, this model is has been ruled out by the latest CMB data. But it's not by much, but this model by itself is ruled out.
I also have another question. Yeah, about the vacuum choice. I don't know if you're going to discuss about that. But how important the vacuum choice is?
Very important. When I told you, right, I was making delta phi, this for tau went to minus infinity, this was e to the minus ik tau divided by square root of 2k. In the literature, this is called the Bunch-Davis vacuum. It's essentially the same vacuum that you would write in Minkowski. This is the least energy vacuum, and so that's what people typically assume. But for example, you could have a model where you would say, no, my vacuum initially is populated. So my vacuum is different from that. And then the results will be different, and people have also studied this as well. But let me just say that this is the simplest choice, that, and it fits the data. So that's why this is probably the most popular one.
But it's an arbitrary choice, right?
Arbitrary in the extent that is the simplest choice and if it's the data. So, you know, always in science, if you have something, you can make it more complicated. The question is whether you should or you should not. But indeed, there is a huge literature also on this. Yes, please.
One question, because we calculate the value of the field where the inflation has to end, but there is no specific point on the slope where it can start.
Very good.
Okay,
two points. There is a fact that I didn't discuss here about quantum diffusion. And if phi is very, very large, just the addition of quantum perturbations will become more important than the classical motion. But this happens far, far away, so it doesn't concern us. So our question is phenomenology, and that's what I'm going to address now. What is the value of n? Because, you see, when it starts, it's a badly posed question in the phenomenological context because essentially, most probably, you cannot see experimentally when it starts. So maybe the question we need to ask is the scale that we see in the CMB, when were they produced? Were produced when the inflaton was here. And in a sense, that's exactly what this question is about. What value of n should I put when I compare with CMB experiments? That's what we're going to discuss now.
Marco?
Yes?
Some questions and Zoom about m, little m. So can you explain again what is little m?
Little m?
Yeah.
Little m is just a parameter, is the mass of the inflaton field, right? So imagine I have a generic potential. And if I have a generic potential, I can ask what is the mass of the field from the potential. By definition, m squared is a half the second derivative of the potential, evaluated in zero, if I have a minimum in zero. So if this is the definition of a mass, if I have a potential which has only the quadratic term, that's how I'm going to write it. And then there may be other terms, but this is the mass term. Now, if you look for this model, if you just look at the normalization of the perturbations, m is of the order 10 to the 13 GeV. But for our discussion, m is just a constant parameter. So, okay, we understood that it's very important to know the value of n to do any phenomenology. And now the question that comes about is which value of n should I choose when I compare with the CMB data? And in order to answer this question, I must do a little digression. And I need to speak about reheating after inflation. Because we are going to see these two are very much connected. So during inflation, volume goes as essentially a cube. This is how much the volume grows. So this will be e to the number of e folds to the cube. So e to the 3n. And we are going to see that typically we expect n, we will see, n could be order 50 to 60. So during inflation, you see the space grows by a lot. So if there are particles at the onset of inflation, these particles just get diluted away and you don't see them anymore. So everything that is left after inflation, essentially in this simplest version, is the inflaton field. So everything you see, and also everything that you don't see, was created by the decay of the inflaton. Maybe not directly by the decay of the inflaton, but maybe the inflaton decays in matter, let's say, where matter I just mean standard model fields, or maybe decays in something else that then it decays to matter. We don't know, but essentially everything that we see in this scenario needs to start from the decay of the inflaton field. So this is an extremely important process, right? And we have essentially reheating, I was mentioning yesterday, but let me say it again. For me, it's a very broad word, and it is all processes from decay of the inflaton to establishment of the hot thermal bath. Of Big Bang theory. So right, naively, right, if you think about the Big Bang, that if you ask everyone on the street, either they say what, or they will say that the temperature was infinite at early time. But this is, in the context of inflation, this is an extrapolation. We would say, no, at some point the temperature was created, because the inflaton decays, right? That's the basic idea. But from here on, this would be the standard Big Bang theory, and here instead is reheating. So that's what we need to discuss. There are some requirements, not very stringent, but nonetheless. One is that the temperature should be greater than about 2 MeV, because you need Big Bang nucleosynthesis. And also then you need to have a cold dark matter, let's say dark matter, and then you need baryon asymmetry. So these are three things that need to be taken into account during your reheating process. Now, why do I speak about reheating? Well, reheating is the most unknown cosmological period. As I told you, essentially, if I do an hour of time, right, this is 1 second. This is when BBN, Big Bang nucleosynthesis, starts. And then we know very well the history, right? We have radiation domination, then we have matter domination. We know what the equality time is. Then today we have lambda domination. And then before, right, we have inflation. And we can at least test some part of the inflation through the CMB. But then reheating, we really have very little, if non direct observational reach to it. And so this is certainly the most unknown part. And there is uncertainty associated to that. And as we're going to see, this uncertainty reflects on the value of n, that is the number of efforts. So let me precisely discuss this. So what I want to emphasize now is that there are uncertainties in reheating. I want to show that these reflect into uncertainty in inflationary predictions. Even if I know the model of inflation, suppose really I knew that this is the right model of inflation, still I would have some problems in making predictions due to the fact that there is this uncertainty in reheating. That's what we're going to discuss now. So you know that Planck, right, gives the most accurate CMB measurement on its own. So Planck pivot scale is chosen to be 0.05 megaparsec to the minus 1. So Planck gives a result, right? You open the abstract of Planck, and Planck tells you millions of numbers. For example, what is the spectral tilt? What are the limits on tensor to scalar ratio? But then these numbers depend on the scale, as we discussed. And Planck typically gives these numbers at these pivot scales. And so the question that we ask is, at which value of n, at which effort n was this scale produced? Was this scale produced? That's the question. So let me do a cartoon to visualize what we are saying. So here we have the scales. Here we have time. And now I need to put a few lines. This is what I call the time tk. Here is what I call the time t end. Here is what I will call the time reheating. And here is what I call today. So this is today. This is a end of inflation. This is end of reheating. And here is when the mod left the horizon. So let me just do inflation. During inflation, this would be h to the minus 1. Remember, h grows very slightly, but is essentially very close to constant. And then here, there will be some power law. And here, instead, is what physical scales do. And this is the Planck pivot scale. So this is the wavelength. That's what he did. So the scale has re-entered in our sky. I'm neglecting, here I should take a small amount of energy density, our dark energy domination here, but I am neglecting this part. And that's essentially the calculation that I need to do. And the number of E falls is here. So what I need to say, right, I need to find, essentially given the value of lambda, I need to find, and given that today I observe the scale here, I need to trace it back, and I need to find what is the value of n. So here is the reheating stage. And here is radiation domination, matter domination, and there will be also lambda domination for a little bit. So what are the unknown parameters that I would like to know in order to really do this plot? So there are some unknown inflationary parameters. One is rho k, which is equal nearly the inflaton potential. This is the energy density at horizon crossing. Would tell me the energy of the universe at this moment here. Since the inflaton is going very slowly, I can neglect the kinetic energy of the inflaton. Then another parameter that I don't know is the energy density at the end of inflation. This is no longer equal to the potential of the inflaton, right? Because at the end of the inflation, the inflaton is moving fast. And these are instead the unknown reheating parameters. Is essentially rho reheating. So is the energy density at the end of reheating. And also, I don't know the equation of state. So let me say this is an effective equation of state. During reheating. Remember, we discussed yesterday the equation of state, right? What we say, for example, if we have radiation, this is equal to 1/3. If you have matter, the equation of state is equal to 0. If you have a cosmological constant, the equation of state is minus 1. But what was the equation of state during reheating? And why should it be constant? It probably was not even constant, but we could imagine an average equation of state. So if I want to consider an average equation of state, what was the nature of the dominant source during reheating? And I will discuss different possibilities. So now I need to have horizon crossing in this plot here. Horizon crossing is defined to be when lambda divided by 2 pi, which is a over k. Remember, this would be the usual relation that we have for Minkowski between the wavelength and the wave number. But now lambda grows as the scale factor. And when this is equal h to the minus 1, this is the moment. You see there is one horizon crossing here. And then, of course, there will be the horizon crossing today when it re-enters. And then remember the number of e-folds that we just defined was this one here, a and e to the minus n. So the scale factor was smaller, and this was therefore positive. Now you can show, and this will be another homework. n is about 55.6 plus 2 logarithm vk to the half divided by 10 to the 16 GV plus logarithm 10 to the 16 GV rho n to the 1/4 plus 1 minus 3w 12 1 plus w logarithm rho reheating rho n. So you see, if you know the evolution of these, here you know the evolution, depends on the inflationary model. Here you know the evolution if you know the equation of state. And here you certainly know the evolution. So if you know the equation of state here, you would know the slopes. Then if you know these times, in order to know these times, you would need to know what was the energy at that given amount of time. Then you can redo this plot. And so you can take a given scale on your sky. This will be the length that you measure in your sky, and you can trace it back to this moment, and you can compute the number of Eiffels. That's what this relation is telling us. That if you know the scale, this is true for the pivot scale. And this seems a bit mysterious, but if you do the homework, I'll try to guide you. It's not particularly hard to see this. Essentially, it really means that we just need to take this number here, and we need to trace it back through this history until we find this value here. And you can see here there is this magical number that is almost 60, that is essentially what justifies our choice. You need to just do the algebra, and it's not particularly difficult in a sense. But what I want to discuss with you, you see, imagine that, you see, there are the first line, there is these terms that are uncertainty in the inflaton model, because we know the scale of the inflaton at horizon crossing and the scale of the inflaton at the end. Instead, the last line is a term that encodes the physics of reheating. This is the equation of state during reheating, and this is the energy density at the end of reheating. And so this is uncertainty due to the fact that we don't know exactly what went on through reheating. And so I want to now evaluate this term. Because imagine that this term is always 0.5. Okay, I don't know what it is, but I don't care, right? If I see that this term would be 0.5, okay, who cares? I don't know what it is, okay, but essentially this doesn't really play any role. But imagine that instead this term is 10 or 15, then it plays a big role, because out of 60, out of 55, you have an uncertainty, which is a big number. So now I want to understand what this term can be, and whether it is important, right? Whether it's something that I can forget about it, or whether it's something that I need to keep on the back of my mind. And so,
what is omega and what is effective about it?
Effective, I mean that imagine that reheating, there was maybe a species that dominates and is massive. So at that moment, W is equal to zero. Then the species decay, then W becomes 1/3. Then another massive species take over, W is equal to zero. And then you would compute an average. So essentially, it's an effective number. Just tell me what is the average behavior during reheating. You know, this is, you see, since I don't really know anything, this is the simplest thing I can try to do. At least I will learn what was the average thing going on at that moment. And I want to discuss with you two extreme cases. And what is this value here for the quickest possible reheating? And for this, okay, maybe I should keep this. I should evaluate this term for the quickest possible reheating and for the slowest possible reheating. Let me call this term delta n. Is the number of Eiffels that is associated to the physics of reheating. Now, what is the quickest possible thing that you can imagine? The inflaton decays immediately. And therefore, essentially, rho n is equal to rho reheating. And so this term is equal to zero. So if inflaton immediate decay, this gives me delta n is equal to zero. Essentially, it's obvious, right? The immediate reheating means that this time coincides with this time. Inflaton decays right away, then this time will be the same time, and therefore there is delta n is equal to zero. Delta n is how much you accumulate during this period. Okay? Now let's instead discuss what is the slowest possible decay. And let me assume, right, that this was a cartoon that I already drew about this will be the potential of the inflaton. So this is phi v. And the inflaton at reheating is oscillating about the minimum of the potential. So heuristically, we can imagine that the inflaton does some oscillations if I add these t and phi. And maybe the amplitude of the oscillation is decreasing. Due to the expansion of the universe. This is the end of inflation, right? The inflaton arrives here. If the inflaton decays right away, okay, that's done. Delta n is equal to zero. But if the inflaton stays around for a long time, the inflaton will keep oscillating. Could do billions or, I don't know, a lot of it. We will see how much. It can do a lot of oscillations. And it does not decay. It's just there that it keeps oscillating. And its amplitude, the oscillations will decrease because of the expansion of the universe. But these essentially will just go on for a long amount of time. And the equations that govern these are this equation here. And it's essentially, if you just, let's take a massive inflaton. So let's just take the potential for a massive inflaton field. This will be m squared phi is equal to zero. This will be a half m squared phi squared. And so just if you look at the first equation, you recognize almost the equation of the simple harmonic oscillator, right? If there was not this term, this will be the equation of the simple harmonic oscillator. But then you see that you have a friction term. Remember, in the simple harmonic oscillator, a friction term would be something that is acceleration is equal minus gamma velocity. Right? This would be a friction term. I teach mechanics first year, so I remember about this. Okay? So, but what is the point here? That this gamma depends on the inflaton itself. So it's a bit more complicated system, because you see the friction is proportional to the Hubble rate, and the Hubble rate depends on the value of the inflaton. So it's a system which is a bit more complicated. It's not just constant friction. However, you know, since we all have done physics one, right, that we expect damped oscillations, right, oscillations that are decreasing with time. And now we can ask ourselves, okay, how does it really decrease? And in order to do how it really decreases, we can just do the virial theorem. We can apply the virial theorem, neglecting the decrease of the amplitude. During a few oscillations. Because the amplitude is decreasing with the time scale h to the minus 1. And h at this point becomes much smaller than m. Because phi is smaller than Planck mass. So the Abbot rate becomes much smaller than the oscillation rate. So the inflaton oscillates with a time scale n to the minus 1, and the amplitude decreases with a time scale h to the minus 1. So the amplitude decreases adiabatically. It decreases very, very slowly. So during a few oscillations, we can neglect the decrease of the amplitude. And we can use the virial theorem. And remember that the virial theorem tells you that the average of the kinetic energy is equal to the average of the potential energy. This will be for the simple harmonic oscillator, for example. So you, if you have so, remember that the pressure, what is the average of the pressure? The pressure is exactly 1 half phi dot square minus V, which is a kinetic minus potential. And this is equal to 0. So in this model, during oscillations, W effective is equal to 0. Now, the equation of state keeps varying during the oscillations. And whenever the inflaton is at a minimum, the equation of state is like the one of vacuum. And then, it's the one which is dominated by kinetic energy. So the equation of state here is W is equal plus 1. And here is like if it was a vacuum, so W is equal minus 1. The equation of state of the inflaton keeps oscillating between minus 1 and plus 1. On an average, is equal to 0 due to the virial theorem. So essentially, the inflaton behaves as matter. So now you see the two different scenarios. First of all, the first immediate inflaton decay. So you immediately produce the thermal bath, delta n is equal to 0. And then there is this other decay that is extremely slow. And for a lot of time, the equation of state of the universe is W is equal to 0. So now let's evaluate this term, assuming that now we understand that W is equal to 0. So we have delta n is essentially 1 over 12 logarithm rho reheating divided by rho n. And now let's take the slowest possible decay. This thing could be of the order of MeV. You see, I told you that you just need to have a thermal temperature is sufficiently to have BBN thermal bath. And this could be as high as 10 to the 16 GeV. These are energy density, so you need to put to the 4 power. You see, this is really the slowest possible ever decay of the inflaton field. And this ratio, if you compute it, it will give the number minus 15. So essentially, it is delta n. We don't know what it is, but it's something between minus 15 and 0. So now you see that having a term that is delta n, which is something between 0 and minus 15, it's huge compared to 55. And if we now go to even the Planck paper, so let me see if I can show it. I mean, I'm sure we are all familiar with this, but nonetheless. This was the Planck paper, the latest, I guess, Planck paper. And you can see that these are the same predictions that I was telling you, right, for the primordial tilt and the tensor to scalar ratio. And the ellipses or the half ellipses will be from the CMB data. And now you see that they studied a lot of different models. But you see that one inflaton model is not a point. And here they evaluate the phenomenological predictions for n that goes between 50 and 60. So they take something, they say, okay, you see 55 is the central value, in a sense, and then we think reasonable to have an uncertainty of order 10. And so you see that's what we get. So imagine, right, this was the model that we discussed a moment ago. You see now it's ruled out, m squared phi squared.
Can I use the
point? Yes, 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 yes. Okay, no. So, no, this is the point. Okay. And you can see that every given model is not given as a point, but it is given as a line because of these uncertainties during reheating. And you see that it's sizable. Okay? So delta n, I think I justified why we take delta n is equal 60. And then, however, I think I try to make the point that there is uncertainty associated to this. How much time do I have? 10 minutes still? I think I started a little later. So, okay, I'm gonna finish one more thing that I want to discuss. Sorry, maybe I should stop share. Okay. I want to now start a little more to discuss about reheating, because I think I proved the relevance.
There is a question about VK. Maybe not before you erase, they can repeat what was VK.
VK is the potential of the inflaton when the mode left the horizon. So we are going to discuss reheating, making initially some very simple assumptions, and then we are going to simply make it more realistic by dropping the assumptions. So the first assumption I want to make is instantaneous inflaton decay. And instantaneous thermalization. By here, instantaneous, I don't mean exactly at the end of inflation. I mean there will be some decay rate. So there will be a moment when the inflaton decays. So let me just compute what in this context will be the reheating temperature. Now, when you have a process in the time t, which is of the order inverse h, the number of processes taking place integral gamma dt, which is of the order of gamma over h, because delta t is of the order of 1 over h. So gamma is the rate for a process. Notice that gamma has mass dimension plus 1, because you see this is number of process, so this is a dimensionless quantity, and this has mass dimension minus 1 in natural units. So gamma is the dimension of an energy. This is the decay rate of the inflaton field. And the number of processes that take place is the integral of gamma in one Hubble time. This is the amount of processes that take place in that time, which is parametrically gamma divided by h. So you see, best by looking at this relation here, we can really say the decay happens when gamma is equal h. Typically, h is a function of time. H initially is greater than gamma. At some point, H decreases. At the moment when gamma is equal H, we say this is the decay of the inflaton. And here, we are going to say that the inflaton decays instantaneously, immediately at that time. So now, we can also find the temperature, because if the inflaton decays and you have a thermal bath, because we are saying that there is instantaneous thermalization of the decay products of the inflaton, we are just going to write gamma, let's do gamma square, h square, is equal to rho divided by 3m Planck square. And this will be the rho of the thermal bath. So the idea is that at some point, when gamma is equal h, all the inflaton decays. This is just a very sudden approximation. And the decay products thermalize immediately. If you do so, then this will be 1 over 3m Planck square, a pi square 30, if I remember right, yeah, g star t reheating to the 4. This is the number of relativistic degrees of freedom. which is of order 100, at least in the standard model, is of order of 100. And essentially, from this relation, we'll find that parametrically, the reheating temperature is of the order of gamma square, gamma and Planck square root. So you know the decay of the inflaton. From the decay rate of the inflaton, you can immediately find what is the reheating temperature. And the figure, the plot I was telling you, is the one that I was telling you before. So here is time. Here is when there is the value gamma is equal H. So here is the temperature. Initially, there is no temperature. And then, all of a sudden, you form the temperature. And then here, the temperature goes as 1 over A. And this value here is the reheating temperature, which is parametrically gamma and Planck. So this will be that you see the inflaton here is oscillating. So there are the inflaton oscillations. And then all of a sudden, the inflaton decays and is going to produce the thermal bath. Probably I will stop here. Do you have any questions? Yes, please. No, this will be a different scenario. And for example, this will
sorry,
be what
Marco, you're... can you repeat?
Yes. So the question was, I was doing a special case in which the inflaton was oscillating about the minimum of the potential. But then the question is, what about if I have a potential, like for example, like this? So where the inflaton rolls, and then it keeps rolling. And then in this case, you would have a different scenario, where here you have kination, and here the equation of state instead is plus 1, because you just have kinetic energy. And this is a plausible scenario, but I was just more simply minded. Imagine that there is a minimum in the potential. Maybe here is, okay, but in principle one could imagine something like that. Or could imagine that the inflaton decays into a field that is massless, and so it gives all kinetic energy. Yeah, it's possible. You see, it's part of the uncertainties related to reheating. Yes?
So we said that, I think it is a mark.
You said that we want reheating to happen before Big Bang nuclear synthesis? But there is also, is there also an upper bound?
We'll discuss this tomorrow.
Okay.
There is, depending what within models. So if you assume some models, for example, there is an upper bound for not overproducing gravitinos, for example.
Okay.
Depends on what model you have in mind. But the lower bound is really robust. The upper bound depends on the model.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay, so I'll end up here and I'll see you tomorrow.
Thank you.
Thank you.